Welcome, everyone, to the Super Nerd Factory Break Room, our podcast where we interview some of our close friends. And today we have Jarrett Balogh, artist, composer, musician. How are you doing today, Jarrett?
Doing good, and yourself?
Oh, can't complain. How are you doing today, Josh?
You're staring at Jared really creepy right now.
Well, I can get closer to the microphone. I think we all should.
I don't want to be here anymore.
But anyway, Jarrett, so we have you here today to talk about your record label and sort of what you do with that. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your record label and your band and everything that you do, because you're a master of many things.
Tell us about your knife fighting career.
I only had like 3 knife fighting opportunities.
It counts.
Okay, maybe after I talk about music stuff first, we'll get into that.
That's fine.
Well, actually, it's not a record label so much as it is a net label. It's called Altered State Reflections, and I think I have almost like 110 releases on there. They're mostly free downloads, Creative Commons license albums. They're either singles or EPs or full lengths, and it's pretty much experimental and avant-garde type music. So you're not going to hear your typical mainstream radio music on there. And I've released, I think, some cassettes and CDs on there too, and some paid digital downloads. But it's pretty interesting stuff. It's music and artists from all around the world. Probably every corner, you know, Europe, Asia, South America, Canada, all over US. So
yeah, we should point out Jarrett does all the music that we have in our other podcast, as well as this one.
So I assume that was probably the most exciting thing ever for you to be a part of our show.
I'm honored. Honestly, really am. You guys are doing good.
Yeah, pretty much everything we've ever used is actually from something part of Jarrett is part of. Be it your band, because you're in several bands technically, right?
Actually, a bunch. I can name them off to plug them.
Like, and these are all active, right?
Yeah, all active bands. Like, I just launched Life Like Thunderstorms. I'm in Aniqatia, Pink Hex. I play with Nate Marks. I'm with Billy Mac Collector. And I do solo improv stuff, noise.
Yeah, because...
And jazz.
And then that's a whole... Noise is a style, right? Is that considered music or what?
I consider it music.
All right. Now, how'd you get into that?
I actually got into noise, I think, in the 90s, mid-90s. Just, it started off with feedback on guitar, and then you start running it through processors and get other processors, and you just, it's almost, I consider it almost like another form of jazz, like free jazz. But it's just, instead of notes and using drums or bass or guitar, I mean, you could use drums and guitars, but you run it through processors or any different type of thing to make, you know, white noise processors, effects pedals and effects boards. So,
well, now with something, because noise doesn't necessarily follow any type of rhythm, correct? It's just...
It could either be rhythmic or it could be no rhythm.
Okay.
There's no pattern. That's why I consider it like another form of jazz.
Like, let's say you're about to start a new song. How do you mentally prepare for doing that? Do you already have something in your head?
For me, speaking for myself, I don't. I just create on the spot. It's basically, like a lot of times with my noise gear, I have no idea how it's going to be acting that day. It could be temperamental. Like one day, it could sound different.
Okay, so it might be a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I think. It's so wild. Noise. It's
limited edition music.
It is.
Really?
It can't be reproduced. I think that's the amazing thing about it.
Now, with you doing, because you do so many different styles of music, do you start a song and then just kind of fit it wherever it needs to go? Or do you all right, I'm going to do noise tonight. I'm going to do rock tonight.
In all honesty, I very, very rarely plan anything out. Whatever comes to me, whatever I'm feeling, that's what I do. Like, I really have no rhyme or reason or patterns or thoughts or emotions. I could be in the happiest mood and write the saddest song, or be in the saddest song or saddest mood and write the happiest song, just to be kind of basic. And I really, it comes down to, I don't have really any thought out. I kind of just tap into
the moment. It's all feeling, kind of.
It's all feeling. I found out for me, that's the way I work the best. Like with John before, when I kind of wrote that song for the podcast, and it was just, I was telling you how it was kind of hard for me to do. Like, you gave me some type of ideas of what you thought, and I told you I'm just really good at creating on the spot, and people just picking the songs and placing it into their podcasts or videos or movies or whatever like that. But I'm really not good at having like a criteria and kind of building off it, because for me, everybody has their own interpretation of what something is. What it happy is, what sad is, what wacky is, what dark is, you know, what's light.
Sure.
You know. I think it might be good to be like, oh, I really don't like it, or it could be the other way around. So I really don't like creating
what,
like
what
that.
What type of mood were you in when you wrote your hockey music?
I was going to ask the same question.
I was pissed and sad.
Because the Flyers lost?
Well, I think that was the year they lost to Tampa Bay in the seventh game in the conference finals. I think they lost by... I think they lost 3-2 down in Tampa. And I knew everybody was talking about how after the season they're going to go on a strike and it's going to be a bad one. And now I was just like super sad that they lost to Tampa and they could have went to the Stanley Cup. And you had no idea when they were coming back.
Yeah.
And I just like, I waited to release. I actually wrote that hockey album, Music for Hockey. I had that sitting until hockey came back, and I waited until the All-Star break of, I think, 2014 to release it.
Oh, wow. So you sat on that for a while.
Yeah. Just to maybe kind of, hopefully kind of have a little part of maybe making hockey cool. I always liked hockey.
Yeah. We always talk about hockey when we're together, when hockey season's on, because Josh doesn't watch sports.
Nope.
There's tons of fighting in it.
I'm in.
I even wrote a song. I went to a fight in a hockey game broke out. That's one of the titles of the song.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't see that one. Now, do you hold off on releasing music? Is that a normal thing?
Sometimes. It all depends.
It just, once again, depends on your mood, on how it's going to go?
I've been told so many times and read stuff about, especially with computers now and social media, to look at your all the information of when the best time to post and for me, like, just today I released that Life Like Thunderstorms. I'm like, it's like Friday afternoon or evening, everybody's getting ready to party. A lot of my friends and fans in Europe, they're probably half drunk already. They're gonna miss the post, whatever. I really don't pay attention to stuff like that, when to release it, what music I'm going to write, how I'm going to write it, whether people are going to like it or not. I'll post things at random times just on the way I feel. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So,
sure. Let's roll back a little bit. So, were you always into music, or did you, like, when did you find music that you wanted to start writing and performing?
Well, a brief history. I mean, I know Josh probably knows this too. I played sports up until I was like 19 years old. I always loved music, but I never played it. And I started music around 19, 20 years old.
So pretty late for someone to get into music.
Yeah. When I first got in, it was kind of hard, kind of going from the sports world to the music world, because it's way different. It's mm-hmm. like the mentality is different. You know, I'm used to coaches screaming at me, practicing every day, all this rigorous stuff, and then you get in the music world and everybody's smoking weed, drinking, you know, they're so laid back and they really don't give a shit. Oh, am I allowed to curse?
You are now.
Okay.
What do you think?
Is this G-rated?
Do you think this is a fucking kids podcast?
All right.
Only I'm allowed to curse.
Okay.
Now you can curse. Do you think that's what drew you towards music, was the freedom versus the strict ruling of sports?
No, it was the drugs and alcohol.
Yeah, we all, even when we were on the sports teams, we all smoked and drank. Even though we signed something on high school teams that you're not supposed to drink and smoke or you'll be kicked off the team, we all did it. So.
Yeah, I guess it didn't scare anyone.
Actually, I like the whole regimented and like disciplined side of sports and the competition, even though it's really not my natural, what do you call it? Natural being of myself.
Okay. Like a personality.
Yeah, my personality. So, so basically when I got into music, I'll tell you what, I had my guard down to receiving anything. Mm-hmm. I was open to any style of music. I mean, before I got into music, I mean, my parents were into like the Beatles and Elvis and stuff like that, but my dad really was into like soul music and R&B. And then like in the 80s, I was really into hip hop, like old school rap, like when I thought it was like the golden era.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got in like late 80s, early 90s, I got into like thrash metal, no glam metal, but and grunge, like all that. And then it just evolved. I mean, it just totally just went in a million different directions.
Sure. Do you think your dad being into jazz kind of has an influence on what you're doing now? Because a lot of your stuff seems to be more jazz focused.
He wasn't into jazz. He was into soul and Motown, I guess. I don't know. I think the soul part, like for me, soul is just not like a genre of music. Like I have that one project, Transatlantic Rage Balogh, that's a collaboration of two of my projects, my solo compositional project and my one like extreme editing project, and it's dark ambient, and I consider that soul. Mm-hmm. Because soul comes into so many different forms. It's just not, you know, Motown or what they call soul, the soul genre.
Yeah.
You know, metal and hardcore has soul. Anything, mm-hmm. any type of music that you just dump your whole energy out. And if you're being genuine and not being contrived and not being fake, if you're actually just being who you are and just not holding back, I think that's soul. So maybe that's...
So what you're saying is you're down with Taylor Swift.
No. maybe her looks, but not her music. Not maybe, I am.
What is your feelings on the state of popular music today in general?
I don't have opinion because I don't listen to it.
You just...
Ever.
Now, what do you say you're part of? Are you part of an indie scene? You don't put yourself into anything?
That's exactly it. I would say the only scene I would say I'm a part of is the Creative Commons.
Okay. So that is a scene of itself?
I would think it is. I don't think there's actually an official scene, but
oh, yeah.
I mean, the people I associate myself with, I would say consider themselves a part of that, which I'm honored. I really think it's one of the best scenes and one of the most unknown and just under the super radar type scenes. Like a lot of the stuff that's, you know, out now, these guys were doing, it's like there's like mainstream underground and probably below underground. These guys might be below that. They're under the radar. They're just...
So they're in a missile silo in the middle of Iowa?
kind of, but they're affecting music in bigger ways than what's actually being shown.
Yeah, they create the initial wave, I guess.
Yeah.
Now, you do collaborations with people all over the world, right?
Yeah.
Now, how does something like that play out?
Being open-minded, and I think one of the key things is being under, not being so, what's the right word, ethnocentric, that some people that I deal with or collaborate with, they're from, you know, Malaysia or South America, and they have a lot of disadvantages, you know, over you, and like dealing with collaborating with them, they might not have good internet connection, or they might not have access to a computer all the time, or the best gear, or their gear's not working, and language barriers. Mm-hmm. The one thing that I deal with all the time, if I had a dollar every time an international person apologized for me for not speaking English well, I would be a millionaire. They, being American, we only speak English or American, and some of these artists know 2, 3, 4 different languages, and they all apologize, like, just because I'm from America, they should know English, but even though they know a bunch of different languages.
Sure. With kind of going on that, do you find it easier to work with those international people?
I have a lot of fun. Yeah, it's so interesting, and you learn so much with dealing with not only different personalities, but it's just a different culture shock.
Mm-hmm.
Not a culture shock, but it's like, if you're open to it, it helps you grow and it helps you evolve. I mean, I remember all my collaborations very vividly. Great experiences.
So, and you're also a painter too. How'd you get into painting? No comment.
It sounds really strange if I truly tell you one of the reasons why. Like, I got out of sports and I got into music. And in the beginning, like, I don't have the access to creating music like I did then.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it was, you know, playing the drums, and I could only play the drums at certain times. And I could only play the guitar at certain times because of noise level.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just fill it in with painting because it was another form of creating.
Sure.
And it was another way of dealing with emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of punching people in the face when I'm pissed or going to the bar because I'm sad and drinking, I would go and paint.
Sure. I mean, people use it for therapy, so.
Yeah, I would say it's more therapeutic. And I would say painting is more natural, and I think that's my strong suit over music. I think that's more natural for me than music.
So when are we seeing the Jared Balogh Art Gallery?
Hopefully opening? Soon. I've been working on it. I got all my paintings cataloged and documented through photos, and I've been working on it, so.
How many paintings do you have?
Well over 100.
Oh, wow.
I think I painted like 3 things in my life.
And I paint the same way I write music. Like, I'll go down there and I'll just paint something random. As I'm painting, I'll start seeing something, and that's the way I create.
Do you still have the Winnie the Pooh?
That's funny that you say that, is because when we took the pictures of it, Lisa and I, we took the pictures of it a couple weeks ago. I'm like, when I die, my cousin Josh is getting the Winnie the Pooh and the Winnie the Pooh in hell and the devil in the 100-acre woods.
Did you ever see those pictures?
No.
We'll show a picture of this. We'll have a link to the picture, but as you just said, it's Winnie the Pooh sitting in hell, and it's the devil sitting in the woods. It's two different pictures.
That's great.
It's like, it would, the funny thing is my mother-in-law absolutely hates those two paintings. Because actually, the one thing, I made Winnie the Pooh look evil. Because he had like these big fangs, and he looks like he's screaming with all the fire behind him. And then like the devil's in the 100-acre woods, like giving the... like the devil sign, wearing like a Melvin shirt with this big grin and like a happy sun and birds behind him. It's just my sense of humor of flip flopping, you know, just kind of sarcastic. Those are never for sale. Those are just mine, and I'll have it in my will to be clear to Josh.
We should just give it to him now so we can hang it in Lucas's room.
He'll become a serial killer or something like that.
Yeah. That will be the link back to what happened.
No, Lucas will just hate all the things that we like is pretty much what's going to
happen. Yeah, it's almost guaranteed.
We're already gearing him up to hate Star Wars.
Yeah, well, his name's Luke. He's almost guaranteed to hate Star Wars already.
That would be a bad thing.
Yep. How do you feel about Star Wars, seeing as you're sitting in my basement full of Star Wars stuff?
In general?
Yeah.
Well, watching it, you know, growing up in the 70s, I was 2 or 3 years old when... well, not episode one, but what is it, episode 4?
Yeah.
Came out. I think, to be quite honest, it's mind-blowing how popular it is now. I think it's more popular now than it was when it first came out, and it was wildly, wildly popular, almost to a fever point, even in the 70s and 80s, and it just seems like it's levels and levels above that now.
It's 30 years and people still go watch the first movie. I mean, I go to conventions just for it.
Like I said, a lot of people are kind of skeptical that Disney took over, but I think I even said this to you guys. They took over the Muppets, and I love the Muppets.
Yeah.
And I love the two Muppet movies.
Yeah, they were good.
And I'm thinking that if they could do that with the Muppets and keep the integrity intact and maybe even make it better, I think... They're going to do the same thing with Star Wars.
Did you see there's a Muppets TV show coming out?
Yeah. Yeah.
That looks pretty good. They show a trailer for that.
Now you're breaking shit. We're never having Jared back.
It's called the break room.
I not can that never, type of break.
I can never sit in a chair still. I always have to shift and move.
Do you want
to
stand?
No, we're standing.
I'm pacing all over the place.
We just need to get a wireless mic for Jarrett next time.
Yeah.
If I sit there, if I'm not moving, I'm tapping.
As long as you don't knock the Mountain Dew wall over, we're good.
You can't knock our sponsors over, I guess. My Vanna White.
Mountain Dew.
Do the Dew. Is that even their slogan anymore? I don't know what their slogan is.
Ironically, on the last podcast we did, I think that's how I opened with Do the Dew.
You did.
It is destined.
Oh, man. So let's talk about some fun stuff. What's the craziest thing you've seen at a show that you played?
I could tell you.
You could go as many stories as you want to go.
I could tell you the craziest thing and one of the craziest things that were said to me, and both of them are equally crazy. The one thing, the craziest thing, I could actually think about a lot. But
well,
the one,
we got plenty of time.
The one... craziest thing, it was before we started to play at this one. How ironic is this? It was at a fire hall, and it was a fire hall show, and this girl had some type of sweater on, and you could smoke in there at the time. And I guess she bumped up to this against this guy or something that was smoking a cigarette down there, and it caught her shirt on fire.
Holy shit.
And the band was playing, and she just lit up instantly. Holy and crap. She was running around on fire, like literally just not a little bit, but like if somebody doused a whole bunch of gasoline and lit a match on her, type like Hollywood stuntman fire.
Wow.
Holy shit. Someone should have been recording that. That would have been like a music video right
actually,
there.
Actually, I think it is on video. I remember, I think because we were video recording. I might have that on VHS.
Wow.
You need to get that up on YouTube and new music video right
that
there.
That was like 1996, I think. It was right by Dorney Park.
That's like 20 years ago, man.
One of the craziest things that was ever said to me, this just happened a couple years ago, and I can't remember.
It wasn't, do you want to go smoke some crack?
No, this is, that's mild compared to this. I was doing live sound for this cover band, Angel Down, and it was at this bar called the OPP up in the Poconos. And it was at the end of the night, and everybody was drunk. And this guy came up to me, and he goes, "Man, great sound guy." He's like, "You're part of the band too, even though you're not playing." I'm like, "Okay, thanks." I was just kind of like, whatever, this guy's drunk. He goes, "You got to accept my compliment." I'm like, "Okay." He's like, "If you don't accept my compliment, I'm going to punch you in the face." He's like, "Then if you don't accept that compliment, I'm going to murder you." And then Christ. He goes, "If you don't accept that compliment, I'm going to fuck you."
Jesus.
And I just stood there and I said nothing.
And you're still here, so.
I'm still here. But the lineage of I'm going to be punched in the face, then murdered, then fucked. Not punched in the face, fucked, then murdered. But he's going to fuck me after he kills me.
Wow.
Just for doing sound.
And you didn't accept his compliment.
Because you did a good job doing sound.
You did a good job and you didn't say thank you.
Imagine what would happen if you did a bad job.
Yeah. I actually had bad compliments for doing sound and lights during the cover band.
But you had bad compliments?
Yeah, where a guy comes up, he's like, "Man, you got," like he said it to the lead singer, he's like, "You got, man, the sound guy sucks." It was like my first time I've ever did it. And like people were griping about how bad it was.
Well, you know, everyone wants to go see it and they want to see it to the best of.
You know, I'm dealing with the sound and the lights.
I can't tell.
Josh is just making.
You're just in my way.
Josh is making weird.
Bobbing and weaving.
No. Oh,
can't see it.
You can't see the mixer in the video, so. No one saw what you're doing with your hands.
You just look crazy.
I saw what you're doing with your hands. Oh, God.
Under the table.
So what else can we talk to Jared about?
There's so many things. Actually, so a story that you've actually told me before, something that you deal with as an artist is people stealing and using your stuff without permissions.
Yeah, I thought you were going to bring up Mazasuki. I thought you were going to bring up him. That's how you say his name.
If you want to talk about him, I am more than happy to talk about that.
We'll happily take him from you. We need more fans.
Well, actually, they're not stealing my music. What's happening is I release most of my music through Creative Commons 3.0 non-commercial share alike license. I know it's a mouthful, but basically, it's just a more liberal version of a copyright. Basically, I allow people to use my music for like school projects or like a home video or like this podcast. Mm-hmm. As long as you're not making money from it or using it for some type of money promotion, anything that's non-commercial, non-profit. I mean, the license is kind of, there's some gray areas with it, but what I go after is basically I'm just standing up for my intellectual property. Mm-hmm. Where people are either doing it intentionally or unintentionally, where they're using my music for profitable ways and profitable reasons, like web commercials or you know, documentaries that they're selling DVDs or live performances. Mm-hmm. And I could find most of that through YouTube and AdRev.
Like when you blocked us.
Yeah, exactly. Like, when I blocked you guys.
"Hey, Jared, can we use your song?" "Yeah, sure, go ahead. We put it on our band."
Copyright it.
Thanks. It was a trap.
I laugh so hard. I'm like, those suckers.
No, he's getting like his ad rev share on our three views.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll get my hay penny in the mail soon.
Did you buy your Porsche with it yet?
Yeah, but it happens. I mean, I have like 250 songs up on like Free Music Archives or Jamendo or archives.org where they could download it. And I don't know if anybody else is doing it, but a lot of people that release their music Creative Commonsly or Creative Commons way, or I don't know how you say it, but there's people out there breaking that license all over the place. Mm-hmm, and sure. It's basically, I'm just standing up for my intellectual property and what I worked hard for. You know, I'm generous enough, and a lot of people won't release their music through Creative Commons just for that reason, you know, and they'll take advantage of you. Sometimes it's because of language barriers, because the license is only in English. Mm-hmm. But it happens a lot, and I think about it this way. It doesn't matter if you're if you release it, just restrict it with copyright. People still use and abuse your music, whether it's a video or a movie or this podcast. There's people out there that just
they don't care.
Yeah. Sure. Or they think they're not going to get caught.
Sure. Yeah. Like, I mean, we spoke to you about it at length when we first, you know, got up and running.
Yeah.
And like, even same thing with podcasts, you know, we run the Creative Commons license. Like, I talked to you about it, about how we should set it up, you know, if we should run the license. And, you know, we ultimately decided, because it is a free podcast, we don't run any ads on it. We use your music, so we release everything that we do for free, and, you know, is essentially what, to sum up, Jared said, you know, we're releasing our stuff for free, and if anyone takes our stuff and starts, like, monetizing it, that breaks that Creative Commons license.
Yeah,
yeah. So remember, Mountain Dew, don't be using our stuff for commercials.
You got to contact them first. But, like, I really think Creative Commons... Creative Commons is good for artists or podcast, anybody that wants to start out and, you know, build a name, whether it's for a career or just for fun, you know. But
how do you even figure out where you're putting your music? Because I saw, like, you, with your newest album that you put out, you put that on SoundCloud.
Yeah, I put it on Free Music Archives. I put it on Jamendo. I did a YouTube... just a single YouTube track of the whole album, Bandcamp, SoundCloud. I think that's all six.
Like, consistently, you put it on everything when you...
No, just this one.
Why did you decide that?
Well, the reason why I did it is because there's this new platform. I think, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it correctly. It's called Starfrosh. And basically, I think it compiles Free Music Archives, archives.org, Bandcamp, and Jamendo, and it puts it in the rankings. You know, if you upload to all four of those, and the more hits and downloads and plays it gets, it puts it up in the rankings, and the longer it's, you know, in the rankings, the more people will download it, the more exposure you get from it. And that's one of the reasons why I did it. It just started not even a year ago.
Okay.
And SoundCloud's popular, and I always like SoundCloud a lot. And, I mean, YouTube, it's amazing. I have videos on there that are 7, 8 years old, and I think that are pretty good, and they have, like, 25 views after 8 years.
Welcome to our world.
And, you know, and some little kid, you know, uploads a video of like a dog like barking and farting, and it gets like 10 million video or 10 million views.
Dog farts are hilarious, so.
Yeah, but not 10 million views worth.
Have you ever considered about creating a fart channel?
Yes.
Or do you already have one?
I have one. It's hidden.
Or just create fart music. Music to fart to.
It would probably sell pretty good.
No. All right, so here's another question for you. So you do a lot of solo stuff and you do a lot of band stuff. What do you have a preference?
No, I like both.
How How does doing a solo project differ from being in a band, besides obviously working with other people?
Well, say, like, Life Like Thunderstorm solo, if I fuck up, it's all on me. I can't blame it on the drummer or the guitar player or anything, you know? That's like, I always think about that before I go on. I'm like, I can't mess up because they'll know it's me.
So if any members to any of Jared's bands are listening, that's why he's blaming it on you.
Just blame it on Jared.
Yeah. Yep.
But you talked, we briefly brought up Masazuki from Japan.
Yes, all right. Yeah, tell us his story.
I think that's how you say his name. But for some reason, he contacted me on Facebook like a year ago. I think it was about a year ago. And over the last year, no matter where I go, if I'm like in Philly or with my friends or anywhere, everybody goes, "Yo, what's up with that Masazuki guy, your friend?" I'm like, how do you know him? He's like, "Oh, he's been talking to me and he contacted me and this and that."
Yeah, he contacted me.
I'm like, everywhere I go, this guy from Japan, it's like I'm responsible for him in America.
Now he's another artist, right?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. And what kind of music does he do?
He does noise and I think like remixes. Like we'll do a Pink Hex show and I'll upload it to YouTube and archives, and then he'll get that audio of that live show and then remix it with his guitar noise and then he'll run the live noise through, or the live show noise through, like a processor, and then he'll put it to SoundCloud or YouTube. Like, he'll video record it, and then it's just, I'm not making fun of him in any way. I think I'm just making fun of
like how people react.
How everybody reacts that I'm responsible for him. Like, he's terrorizing everybody, in which he isn't. I just think he's, that's where going back, it's different cultures. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe in Japan they're a little bit more fanatical than here in the United States.
They definitely are.
Yeah.
You know,
some bands get huge in Japan that aren't huge here.
Yeah, I mean, There's a cultural barrier. I never thought it was wild, anything that he was doing. I always thought he was just helping out in his way. It's just like my dog Isis.
Now we're flagged on the terror watch list.
Yep.
Thanks, Jared.
And even your dog Archer, you know, you walk in the house, those dogs are nuts. And I kind of take them that way too, like when you first meet him. Mm-hmm. He's just really enthusiastic, and as time goes on, he just kind of settles down, just like our dogs. The more you're around, like after you're here for 10 minutes, they kind of settle down and you're not...
My dog never calms down.
Well, I'm trying to stick up for our dogs, John. But, I mean, that's what, you know, a lot of people just see him as, you know, being crazy, and I don't think he's crazy. I think he's really fun. I think he's...
No, not at all.
He's great, but... Yeah, I don't know why I'm responsible for him.
Well, all right. So on my Facebook, I do not accept people's friend invites.
Yeah, Josh has like six friends.
He is my friend on Facebook.
Yeah. It's a good move.
People
told me that they deleted him. You know,
I don't know.
I deleted him, Jared.
Whatever.
Okay.
I didn't delete him. That's good that you did.
So other than music and stuff, you know, what are your other hobbies when you're not making music or walking your dog Isis?
Oh, I was ready to say that. Walking my dog Isis. Well, I mean, we would go for hikes to how many different state parks. I know we haven't done it in the last year, mainly because I'm playing a lot of different places and Lucas was born.
Yep.
But I still go mountain biking with Nick. Yep. Your cousin, and go to different shows, and I haven't been to a movie for how long.
Why don't you tell everyone what movie you watched that you just watched?
Oh, I'm 40 years old, and when this movie came out, it was 1987. I first watched RoboCop.
What made you even watch it?
Oh, Pink Hex had a show a couple weeks ago, and after we were done playing, you know, we're just drinking and talking about stuff. And we're talking about sci-fi movies. And I'm like, well, maybe I should start watching some sci-fi movies. So I watched RoboCop and I watched AI.
Those are two, like, opposite ends of the spectrum.
But they're sci-fi. I love AI. It's, like, one of my favorite
movies. That's a long movie.
Yeah.
God, I love RoboCop. First rated R movie I ever saw. My dad's like, yeah, there's nothing bad in this. You can watch it. Like,
RoboCop has a lot of bad things.
I'm like, 7 years old. I remember I was at one of my old jobs, and we're arguing about how every, like, 80s movie, there's at least, like, some girl topless, even if it's like for a brief scene. Some guy's arguing with me that RoboCop didn't have any of that. So I like go and watch RoboCop the next day. The first like scene is them in the bathroom. Like everyone's taking a shower.
Yeah. And the thing is when I watch it, I'm like, wow, I can't believe how graphic this is. Even, I mean, I really don't watch graphic movies, but like they're showing people's heads being blown out, or like they're shooting RoboCop like 50 times with machine guns and actually showing it. And I'm like, wow, this is really graphic even for like the, you know, mid to late 80s, and kind of almost groundbreaking in a way how graphic it, like a lot of movies went in that direction.
Well, yeah, that was, they were pulling from like the horror scene, you know, all the B horror movies were all about the gore.
But I love how Kurtwood Smith was in it. Red Foreman from That 70s Show. It's just weird. I watched That 70s Show in entirety like 10 times, and just actually seeing him play something different than Red Foreman was just like bizarre.
And he drives a SUX 6000.
Yeah.
The SUX 6000. They created internet language before there was an internet.
That's true.
But they did have like uploading and downloading like computers back then on in that movie.
Yeah.
How they downloaded the program into him and made him. Thought it was kind of a, I mean, maybe there are other movies out there that were dealt with like the way computers are now. But I mean, I thought that was pretty cool with RoboCop, how they're talking about like the early parts of computerized generation back then with RoboCop. Yeah. How he was programmed, and you know.
Now you need to watch the remake of RoboCop so you can
do give a
us
comparison.
Give us your review on that.
Do you know what? I think I'd rather watch the remake than actually watch 2, 3, and 4.
Yeah. I don't.
Those are just
the remake wrecks. Wasn't as far as remakes go. It's not horrible.
Yeah, but RoboCop 2, 3, and 4.
I don't think I've ever watched those. So
RoboCop 2 is like Highlander 2.
Okay,
it's just bad.
Yeah.
The beginning's okay, but then he gets like a jetpack somewhere in it.
That sounds awesome.
And it's like RoboCop like flying. He has like a jetpack and he's just flying around like Inspector Gadget.
Okay, that sounds pretty awesome.
One of the movies I just watched this week, and I've watched it countless times. It's one of my favorite movies. It's with Eric Bana. It's called Chopper.
Yeah, Chopper's a good movie.
And I've had that movie for quite some time, way before Eric Bana got popular and what Black Hawk Down and the Hulk movies, and I forget what other movies he's in, but every time I watch that movie keeps getting better and better and better, and it was amazing the first time I watched it.
Yeah,
and he, his character, he plays, I forget it, Chopper Reed, I forget his first name, or Mark Chopper Reed, that's his character's name. I think to me it's like a iconic or a legendary character, like Al Swearengen in Deadwood, or like Tony Soprano in the Sopranos, something like that, type of iconic character. But it was like an Australian based film, but it's amazing.
How'd you even find that movie?
Either I rented it or Lisa rented it.
Yeah, just random.
Just at like one movie. The rental places were still existing.
Man, what's a rental place?
Man, I miss like the local
Blockbuster.
Yeah, I do too.
No, we used to have. Do you remember the one that used to be around here?
Oh, you mean the one at the gas station?
Yeah.
Yep.
I love that video store.
There's a rental place at the gas station?
No, it was right next door to the gas station.
Now it's Mario's, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a pizza place now. But that place was great. I miss going in and just like looking at you know, just looking at like the box art and being like, this movie's going to be awesome. Then you take it home, it's a pile of
yeah,
garbage.
You judge it completely off of the cover of the movie.
I'm glad that I don't have to, maybe you guys didn't have to deal with it, but you know, back in the day, if you wanted like a Playboy or like a porn video, you had to manually, and people actually visualized you going and getting it. It's like back then, if you wanted a porn, you had to go to 48 Hours or Blockbuster and
go in the back room.
Go in the back, and people are like, oh, he's a perv. Or if at the 7-Eleven, you wanted a Playboy or a penthouse, you had to wait for like a guy that you could kind of trust. Like, you had to build like a relationship, like a trust relationship, like buy a Slurpee like 10 times before you could go and say, can I have that April issue of Playboy?
Yeah.
And then
I'm the Slurpee guy. Yeah. I'm the Slurpee guy.
And then the guy at 7-Eleven is just like,
it's like
I hate my life.
This is every other person.
Internet porn wiped all that shame away. Now our shame is in private.
Yep.
Except when people post like nude selfies of themselves by accident when the fappening happens.
Oh, man. What would you say is the nerdiest thing that you're into right now?
Because you're part of our nerd network. Like you're a music nerd, but
yeah, I would say music nerd. I know we talked about this before, but I was like a video game nerd back in the day. Like I told you how I literally had to get rid of playing video games.
Yeah, wasn't it a Star Wars game specifically you were addicted to?
It was Star Wars Battleground and like SimCity, where just I wouldn't go anywhere. I would just be like on a beautiful day, I would just be playing those video games. Or like John Madden or like NHL.
I'm gonna show Jarrett World of Warcraft. We're never gonna hear from him again.
Yeah.
That is a place I would love to go again, but I know I'm done.
Like you just lose control.
I won't write anything, produce anything. I'll quit all my bands.
I'll walk
my dog.
Well, Rockstar's Chase the Dragon. This is your addiction.
Man, I think those were my two top games was Star Wars Battleground and SimCities series.
I have a very serious question. Are you familiar with My Little Pony?
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what a brony is?
Is it a...
I see you're looking over here.
No, is it two boy ponies that are bros, like a bromance? Bronies, or
you're
like
not too far off,
or Italian My Little Ponies, like yeah, a little brony.
Yo, Cap, does your mother sew?
Oh God, Josh is horrible at Christopher Walken.
No, that was dead on. That was dead on.
Josh is just pretty much horrible at impressions.
Does your mother sew?
Now I agree because I had no idea who he was impersonating until you said that, and then I knew who he was impersonating.
All right, so. I'm spot on. I should be on a stage right now. All right. So what a brony is? So it's a cartoon, right? So that they re-released the My Little Pony cartoons, and it became huge with like teenage to I would say somewhere between 15 to 40, where they're obsessed over this My Little Pony, and it's not like an adult version. It's the My Little Pony that you're thinking of, like little kid. And a brony is essentially a boy that loves My Little Pony. So I'm going to help you figure out which pony is best suited to you.
Oh, God. Is this like a psychological profile?
It's pretty much it. So,
like if I pick the one, I'm like this serial killer.
No, so the...
You know...
So unless I pick the wrong one, I believe the... There is no current serial killer pony in the My Little Pony series, but we may find different. Now, every hardcore brony associates to one of the characters, so we'll figure out which one you associate to. So I'm going to ask you a few questions, you just give me the answer, I'll read you the answers off here. They're all multiple choice. So if you had an extra hour in a day, which of these subjects would you like to spend more time studying? Math or science? Art? History? English? Or music?
Art.
All right, let me select that. This is 11 questions, by the way. So, what are you most likely to argue about? pop culture, music, movies, TV, anything I'm right about, fashion or beauty, clothes, hair, makeup, causes that are near to my heart.
I would say music.
All right, pop culture. What's your favorite song in Frozen? Do you know? Are you aware of what Frozen is?
I know of it. I don't.
Okay. So going off of the names, do you want to build a snowman? For the first time in forever, Let It Go, Reindeers Are Better Than People, and In Summer. Which?
Reindeers Are Better Than People.
Personally, I would have gone with I Want to Build a Snowman. That's just me.
What's your favorite season? Spring, summer, autumn, or winter?
I hate to admit this because I bitch and gripe about it all the time, but I have to say the winter.
Okay.
Even though it's tough for me with all my broken bones and arthritis.
What's the best part of a rainstorm? Watching the shower, listening for thunder and looking for lightning, searching for rainbows, or splashing?
There's no option of only reason it is to take a shower. Where are they again? I was thinking about my joke.
Listen, man, we're trying to figure out what brony you are. You can't be messing around. All right, so watching the shower, listening for thunder and looking for lightning, searching for rainbows, or splashing?
Oh, the, like hearing for thunder, like the...
Okay, thunder, listening thunder and looking for lightning.
Yeah.
Off the top of your head, do you know your best friend's favorite color? Yes or no?
No, I don't have a specific best friend. I have multiple.
You sound perfect for a brony, then. It's all about friendships. Okay, we got an advertisement here. Skip that. What's the most essential part of a birthday party? The cake, the decorations, the games, singing happy birthday, or hugs?
Hugs.
Jared does give a lot of hugs, so.
No, he doesn't. No.
He only hugs me.
I only hug and Matt. It's Matt and you.
So you're not a big hugger at shows that you go to? If someone comes up to you at a show, would you hug them?
Yeah.
Okay.
What if it was awkward? What if it was an awkward long hug and they didn't want to let go?
After that guy said that compliment about the sound, like a hug, it was like nothing.
You would just embrace them till the end of time?
Yeah, it's friendly.
What was the question again?
What's the most essential part of a birthday party?
Oh, singing.
All right, singing happy birthday.
Because it's super illegal to do. Technically, you can't sing happy birthday.
So you just feel like a rebel when you're doing it? All right.
That's why I send out the foul-mouthed birthday robot song to everybody. I've seen that. From the Free Music Archives.
All right. It's a beautiful day. Where do you want to go? Well, I'm just going to explain to you because there's no words. So basketball, a picnic, I think it's a library, and playing with the dog.
I think back in the day would definitely be shooting some hoops, but now it'd be playing with the dog.
Okay, dog. All right, we're on question 9 here. You meet up with your best friend to find he or she has brought a surprise guest. How do you feel? Excited to meet someone new? Annoyed? I don't mind, but I wish I would have known.
Well, if it was a girl and if she was hot, I would be happy. But
let's say it's a creepy dude.
Well, he could be creepy, but kind of fun. I don't know.
He's not fun. He's the guy that threatened you at the show.
Okay. The one that tell him to get lost or whatever.
So I'm gonna go with annoyed. Okay. So it's asking you to pick your favorite Hello Kitty character. Oh, so
I know it's the original Hello Kitty.
All right. So I don't know which one you want there. So you went with straight up OG Hello Kitty?
Yeah.
All right. So the last question. Make it count. There's a big dance coming up. You're proudly running the planning committee, helping my friends figure out what to wear, helping with snacks, going just to hang out with your friends, not planning on going.
It's either the last two.
So, going just to hang out with friends or not planning on going?
Well, I would say I would hanging out with friends because, you know, there's going to be girls there.
That's the root of everything.
That's the only reason why
I
would
go. This is to find out which brony you are. So it's just going to be all bros.
So at the dance?
So you answered wrong.
So
what brony is he, Josh?
Actually, having technical difficulties. When I select that answer, it just wants me to redo question 11 again.
Oh, man.
Jared's breaking shit again.
We're good. Like I said, I can't sit in the same spot for all.
Well, we're never going to know. So sad. I really wanted to know. I even tested this out before because I really wanted to know which brony Jared was.
My pretty brony.
We'll never know. It's broken. It's literally broken at question 11. I'm going to have to get back to you on your brony.
You could just post the answer on...
Yeah. Whoa. If you want to know the answer, go to supernerdfactory.com.
People are going
to
be in suspense.
Wow, that's really annoying. That's really disappointing.
I think
I just have that way with electronical equipment.
Yeah, so this is your fault. So this is like blaming other band members for issues.
Like, we're... the last song we played at practice today... All of a sudden, our equipment got super loud. We were, all talking about it. Like, the last song, it seemed like all of our equipment was, turned up, and no one touched anything.
I want to dive into that subject, but I think we need to start wrapping up here, because Jared's a ghost hunter.
Oh. I was teasing Nikki on Facebook today. She friended me, and I'm like... You know your kid's gonna be able to see ghosts.
But we're gonna leave your ghost hunting adventures till another time.
Okay, yeah.
We will have to talk about that.
Oh,
sometime,
I have a million and one ghost stories.
But since
paranormal.
Since Josh's thing fucked up,
there it is. Did it?
No.
I have some questions I need to ask you, and I'm going to rate you on these questions. These are yes or no questions. You cannot give me another answer other than yes or no.
Oh no.
All right.
I'm going to have to be smart on answering.
You have to answer the questions within 2 seconds.
Is this like a speed thing?
No.
Okay.
Why did they cotton swab a guy's arm with rubbing alcohol before a lethal injection? Yes or no?
No.
Would a fly without... this is actually a yes or no question.
What question was that? I mean...
All right. This is actually a yes or no question. Would a fly without wings be called a walk?
Yes. Because it couldn't fly.
I said no. Nothing other than yes or no.
I said yes first.
What? Why do kamikaze pilots wear helmets? Yes or no?
No.
Why is the word abbreviation so long?
Yes.
We'll do one more here. How long is a piece of string?
Yes.
Well, Jarrett, I'm going to score you a 10 out of 10.
Even though there was only 4 questions?
Yep. 10 out of 10.
Yes.
10 out of 10, 9 stars out of 3.
Awesome. Sounds like good math to me.
Oh, well.
It's the only kind we know.
Well, Josh is always on math. If you listen to our other podcast, Audio Pollution, Josh is always on math. He doesn't do meth. He's on math. That's what he does.
The thing is, every time when I associate Josh with this podcast, right away, I think about all of his poo stories.
My poops are famous.
He got some famous poops there.
We might start a third podcast just about that. And I already have a third guest for that. That's like a permanent seat. My dad wants to be on it.
The poop cast.
Is it? You should interview him while he's on the toilet.
Yeah, that's how we'll do it.
we're just going to record in the bathroom.
Fuck that. We're going to a public bathroom. We're recording in the public bathroom.
Mm-hmm. Or he could just take a shit in the corner.
I don't think that'd be allowed. I don't think I want to see that.
Smell it.
Yeah. That's premium content.
That's for our Patreon we're launching.
You can get him one of those old timer. The ones that the old people use so they don't go upstairs, like those portable toilets. You could interview him after he eats chili.
Well, on that note, Jarrett, why don't you tell how people, how they can find your music?
On that high note. If you want to see more of Jared's creative thoughts.
Tell people how they can find you.
I would say I have everything linked to my website, alteredstateofmind.net.
Which we'll have all the links through our site.
Yeah, and we'll throw your Twitter up there as well. Because I know you post new releases on your Twitter.
Yeah, I have all my social media links on my main website, like my Facebook, Twitter, Google+, Pinterest, so on and so forth.
I can't figure out what Little Pony he was.
It's a shame.
My night's ruined.
But thanks for coming on, Jarrett.
Thank you for having me. I had a blast.
We will definitely have to continue on with more of your stories.
Yeah.
And it's easy to get Jarrett because he lives down the road.
Half a mile away.
All right, guys, that'll do it for The Break Room. Have a good night, everyone.
SuperNerdFactory.com.